Hi, thanks for joining me. My name is Angela. I'm a horn player here in the Dallas area, and I'm here joined today by David Cooper, principal horn player of the Dallas Symphony, and Alex Carr, concertmaster of the Dallas Symphony. And we're here today to not talk about classical music. If you guys don't mind, we'll just jump right in and ask you a couple questions.
Cool.
Could both of you please just describe a seminal either artist, album, or even a single that you just really poignantly remember from your youth?
Sure. I remember there was this, I used to watch MTV a lot when I was a kid, back when they showed music videos.
I remember.
Yeah, I remember like one video that like stuck out to me was Winona's Big Brown Beaver by Primus. And I remember like, I was terrified of it. They were like wearing these like plastic costumes, dressed up like cowboys, and I couldn't watch it, but I was like drawn in, like I couldn't stop. Also, the music had a really cool, you know, like bass guitar, you know, solos and really cool drum licks, so I was really drawn to Primus.
I had a really weird eclectic taste even when I was a little kid. I would say the three albums that got to me the most were Beatles' White Album.
Oh yeah, remember that.
Which I loved and I was obsessed with for years.
Yeah.
I also love Prince Purple Rain. Actually went to the concert.
Shirts versus blouses.
I'm still obsessed with like completely off that album, but Morris Day at a Time, Jungle Love. I can still listen to that.
Yeah, that's a great tune.
One of the songs that makes me smile more than anything.
Jungle Love.
And then I loved Gaucho by Steely Dan.
Oh wow.
So I think those three albums I was really kind of obsessed with. And if I had to think of one artist that I was obsessed with, I would probably say Jimi Hendrix.
Oh yeah.
Because for me, he had the best of both worlds. I loved his voice, I loved his whole approach to music, but I also loved that he was an instrumentalist. And his guitar playing was just unbelievable.
So
for me, it was,
and his creativity with the licks.
Yeah, and I think later I really got into Sting.
Oh yeah?
Like I loved the Police growing up too, but then when Sting left, I love Zenyatta Mandata, I love Ghost in the Machine. Those were great albums.
Okay. So in classical music, we talk a lot about geniuses, and we talk a lot about like perfection. Like Brahms was an unequivocal genius. He could write a symphony that had no wasted notes. Are there any singles that you guys can describe or albums that are just perfect from beginning to end?
Wow, that's a great question.
Oh my gosh. Abbey Road.
I got one for you. I don't know if you're gonna like it.
What?
Thriller? Michael Jackson.
Oh yeah, it's a really good album.
For me, I gotta say, Michael Jackson was like the Mozart of pop.
Yeah, really.
He was, I would say, an unequivocal genius.
Yeah.
Imagine Michael Jackson, he's 9 years old, and he's singing I'll Be There.
Yeah.
Do you remember that?
Yeah, I do.
To have a little kid with that kind of maturity in his voice.
And timing.
And
then dance moves too.
It's incredible.
Yeah.
Remember when he came out? Do you remember the Motown show?
Yes.
1982, 1983, when Thriller came out and Michael Jackson walked down and did his Motown 25th anniversary special. And he did the moonwalk for the first time.
Yes. It changed
everything.
Yeah, exactly.
It changed everything.
We're talking about the moment. Yeah, it really did.
I love the Beatles, you know, for me, like, the Beatles were, like, my musical education.
I would believe that's no less profound.
Yeah, I mean, for me, like, they were perfect music. Like, you know, they did everything, too. They're, like, you know, they were so eclectic, yet they didn't waste music, and they got the feel, you know. I feel like they really put in the 10,000 hours, though.
Yes.
You know, they, like, from their beginning at the Star Club.
Yes.
Yeah, they figured out what made a hit, what made people move. They did, like, 8-hour sets when they were in Hamburg in the early 1960s. Yeah,
but don't you think they're a lot like, I mean, some of the songs that the Beatles did were a lot like Webern. Sorry, we're not talking about classical music. If you think about like,
you,
like the song I Will.
Number 9? Oh, man, on the White Album?
The most condensed song.
Who knows
and yet,
loved you.
It's one of the most beautiful, poignant songs, and it's this long.
Yeah.
And the Beatles can do that in every little song. It doesn't take Hey Jude, which is forever, or The Long and Winding Road, even which are two of my favorite songs.
Yeah.
But just I will. It's just, it's so moving, it's so, and it's just so little.
What about Elvis, though?
Oh.
I mean, Elvis, like, took, like, a whole genre of music and then, like, you know, opened it up to, you know, a whole other group of people, right? He took, like,
Can't
blues,
Stop Falling in Love With You?
You know? Or what about Chuck Berry? He invented rock and roll. I mean, I grew up listening to Chuck Berry. I love, you know, my parents are older, you know, I have, like, you know, parents that grew up in the 50s and the 60s, and they used to have me listen to the oldies radio station, so, yeah, Chuck Berry was, like, you know, it. Roll Over Beethoven and Johnny B. Good.
I used to love that song.
Yeah, that was one of the first albums I had, and Chuck Berry.
So we already touched on it a little, but I want to go back to it and just expand on it a little bit. We already kind of talked about Michael Jackson and Prince being, like, pretty incredible, and Jimi Hendrix, incredible stage presence. Can you guys talk more about non-classical live performers and what you take from them into your own performance?
Wow. You know, I saw The Grateful Dead.
Did you? With Jerry? No way. I love The Grateful
Dead. Many moons ago. And I'll never forget the spontaneity of these guys. They will riff on one of their tunes for 25 minutes. I think that the people who are probably the most stoned would get the most out of it at that point, because you have to really see the arc of where they're going with everything.
Yeah.
But I love the fact that, like, they were just improvising on stage for so long.
Conversations.
And the constant conversation.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, it was like that dialogue between musicians. It was so special. And then one guy would throw an idea out there, and then the next person would expand on it. And it was like, you know, they truly understood sound and how to make a moment with sound.
Yeah.
Yeah. And
or
like,
jazz. Like, if you look at jazz combos, like looking at, like, Miles Davis and the Miles Davis Quintet. Or, like, I mean, I wish I would have heard them. But can you imagine, like, having, like, Miles Davis and Coltrane and Cannonball Adderley and Bill Evans, and, like, I mean, can you imagine how all those guys on stage just ripping like that?
Yeah.
It's like, are you kidding me?
You know, there's still a bit of the Harlem Renaissance in Harlem, in those jazz areas, you know, like the jazz clubs. Like, you go out and, like, people still get dressed up for, like, a Wednesday night and they go out and, you know, it's like, it's like the soundtrack to that, you know, to their lives, you know? It's like not just like music that's in a museum, it's like soundtrack to their lives.
But think about, like, I mean, okay, and then you go back to rock, like Prince or Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
Michael Jackson on stage is one of the most exciting performers ever. You're riveted watching this guy.
Wow.
Same with Prince, when I saw Prince. You're compelling.
Yeah.
That's the perfect word.
Yeah, yeah.
Compelled. You're compelled to watch these people.
Yeah. And that's what makes
delivering something.
That's what makes a great classical music performer. Sorry to talk about classical music, but, you know, let's just tie it back into what we know, right?
Yep.
Like, when I see someone who's a great classical music performer,
I'm
compelled to see what he's doing. I can't take my eyes off of that performance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's amazing. I mean, also I saw Sting on stage once with his band, and it was like Vinnie Caliuta was playing drums, Kenny Kirkland was playing keyboards. It was an amazing band, and they weren't going crazy or anything, but the musical communication that was going on stage was amazing, and that was riveting. Because sometimes it's the pyrotechnics, but sometimes it's just like, just the way they're playing, what and how they're communicating, like non-verbally or non, you know, like motion-wise, that's such just as exciting.
Last quick question.
Uh-huh.
What's your guilty pleasure that you listen to?
Gosh. We let hip-hop going.
That's not a guilty pleasure. I love that.
I felt guilty listening to hip-hop as a little white girl growing up.
But. I mean, like, rolling down the street, like, in my, like, what, Ford Focus or my, like, Subaru Forester, like...
Do you remember when we went to that Texas Rangers game?
Oh, my God.
And all of us were the Prius?
Yes. We were in the back of a Prius. What were we listening to?
Tupac, like, man.
Yeah, Tupac. And then we're... Oh, my gosh. Yeah, we said, maybe the most Caucasian moment of our lives.
Exactly.
You know, like, and Abe was putting on sunscreen.
Sunscreen is like SPF 75.
SPF 75. Yeah, totally. Yeah,
no,
yeah,
guilty
yeah.
pleasure, 80s pop.
80s pop?
Oh, 80s pop. Exactly. Take On Me by A-ha. What's the Flock of Seagulls, I Ran.
Oh, man, I used to have the haircut here, the Flock of the Seagulls, you know? Like.
Yeah, I will sit there and listen to really bad 80s pop tunes.
Oh my God.
Love
or
it.
Really good.
Hey.
Or exactly, or really
like,
good.
Do you like Toto?
Of course.
Well, thank you guys so much for joining me. This is
our pleasure.
A dream come true to sit with you guys and talk about this. So.
Awesome.
Hey, real quick, let's ask you, what do you listen to? What's your guilty pleasure?
Oh, God. I mean, okay, let me get specific. Ludacris.
Luda.
I love Ludacris.
Oh, I love Ludacris.
So that's my guilty pleasure.
Go on 20s. We bout that. Me and my homies. We bout that.
I was just listening to Mystical.
Mystical? Oh, dude. Oh, my gosh.
Bye. Thanks for watching.
Hey, thank you.
Bye.